Hello, my name's Tom Banshoff. I'm here at Georgetown University with three colleagues from around the world, colleagues with our project on the culture of encounter and the global agenda. I'm joined by Catherine Marshall here in Washington, D.C., by Marcel Uineza of the Society of Jesus at Hekima College in Nairobi, and Johannes Wallacher, who's joining us from the Munich School of Philosophy. So we've been working together over the course of a year with a couple of dozen colleagues from around the world to explore Pope Francis's idea of the culture of encounter and some of its implications for world affairs, a very broad topic. And today we want to focus in on one of the highlights of the past year, which was a conference we attended in Rome, which featured a keynote by Archbishop Paul Gallagher, the Vatican Secretary for Relations with States, on the topic of the culture of encounter and global governance. Each of you have written about this on the website, but we thought we'd have an informal conversation that we could also share and see where that goes. So with that, let me turn it over to you, Catherine, to get us started.
Great. As I reread the speech several times, I think there were six points that really stood out to me. The first was that Monsignor Gallagher really approaches this as a diplomat and from the perspective of peacemaking in situations of conflict. And the role that the Catholic Church, which has such a special role, plays, particularly within the United Nations system. So he refers prominently to the presentation that Pope Francis made at the United Nations and to that those kinds of relationships. One thing that means is that he's not really looking at some other aspects of the Catholic roles, particularly in what you might call social capital or human capital, education, health, the roles, complexities of gender roles, and some of the controversies around it. So it is his concern that with the deterioration of the diplomatic aura and his comment that might makes right. Second point is that I think he focuses very much on this moment as an inflection point and on the multiple but also interconnected crises. This is not an unusual theme. It's one we're hearing often. I'm hearing the current crisis referred to as a polycrisis, but I think that's in many ways the setting for his analysis. And what he's calling for at a very broad level, this is third, is a profound change in attitudes. Fourth point, he notes frequently, and I think it's something he keeps coming back to, that we need to go beyond words or what he even calls idle chatter to action. And needless to say, because the problems are so complex and so interconnected, exactly how that translates into practice is not always clear, but I think that it is in a way the sort of dominant theme in all that he is saying. I was struck by some of his comments about responsibility juxtaposed with rights and clearly a concern with rights as entitlement, seeing that as an important part of the Catholic message, the question of really balancing more the rights and responsibilities, but also an unease with aspects of human rights as they are framed and discussed within the United Nations system, particularly, but also more broadly. And a final comment, which both of my colleagues have also highlighted, is this balance between justice and mercy and charity. The need for justice, the need for truth, but also balancing that with the humanity, which in a sense is a part of the notion of the culture of encounter. So Tom, I can stop there, but that was sort of some of the points that I took out of the speech.
Thanks very much. You've gotten us off to a great start. Marcel, let me turn it over to you.
Oh, thank you very much, Tom and Catherine and Johannes. It's a joy to be together on this video conversation. My writing was a theological reading of Gallagher's keynote speech. So I was looking at three major points: the perspective of love from his talk, and the perspective of human dignity, then justice, and what that means really for our divided world. So those were the three. And I posit, following more or less Pope Francis, I posit this idea that love is willing the good of the other and doing something concrete about it. And with that, you cannot speak of a culture of encounter where we don't have this expression of love, where we will the good of the other, and the other not because we share the same blood, but the other because he or she is created in the image of God. And this love builds bridges, so shatters the chains that isolate us. Those were the words of Archbishop Gallagher. Love enables us to create one great family and where everyone can feel at home. Actually, Pope Francis in Fratelli Tutti also goes back to this expression of love, where he says, love does not care if a brother or a sister in need comes from one place or another. So that theological imperative of love at the heart of any culture of encounter. I can say that from my own personal experience, when I met the man or the persons who killed and exhumed the bones of my relatives, before we could meet and talk, they were monsters. But when we had this exchange, I realized my encounter with them was first of all, enhanced the love, opened my heart, and then there was some life-giving. I think if I may use the word of Catherine, really love or an encounter is the oxygen that we breathe. I think that comes out clearly. And this love gives rise to obligations and rights. So that was the first dimension that I see from his talk. We cannot speak of love in the abstract. It has to be concrete and fosters human dignity. And this human dignity transcends cultural changes. So everyone has this inalienable dignity attached to his being created, he or being created in the image of God. And this has been stamped by the United Nations Declaration for Human Rights. So the dignity that is fostered by the right for education, for shelter, for health, and all the other rights that we have in the United Nations Declaration for Human Rights. For this dignity to be possible, there has to be justice. So in a sense where people are treated as equals, not as means to the end. So those were the three points that I wanted to make from his talk, from his lecture. What does this mean for the divided world? And particularly I focused on the current invasion of Russia to Ukraine. You cannot treat another nation as if it is a means to your end. People have rights to exist. Ukraine has a right to exist. So I wanted to put that across. And Archbishop Gallagher made it clear that the ultimate foundation of lasting peace is seeing others as equal, to use his own words. This is the perspective I was taking, and borrowing from my colleagues, I saw this particularly when I look at Johannes talking about the common good, and the common good to be able to happen or to exist, you have to set up structures that make it sustainable, structures of justice, particularly in places where democracy is on the brink. So that's what I wanted to put and go beyond beyond the culture of entitlement. So those were the things. So love, dignity, justice, and what that means for a divided world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marcel. That's a very useful way of moving from theological categories to ethical and political categories as we think this through. Johannes, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. Thanks, Catherine and Marcel. The aim of my essay is to supplement Archbishop Gallagher's remarks by making a more explicit connection to the principle of the common good. Out of two reasons, I guess. The first is to link the personal aspect, and I think that's in the focus of Archbishop Gallagher's talk. He's looking for personal conversion, the change of personal attitudes, but we need to have a link to the structural reforms if we need to go to the aspect of global governance. And I think the principle of the common good could be very helpful. That's the first reason. The second reason is to establish a stronger connection to secular academic and political debates. I think if we want to translate the religious language into a speech that is understandable for non-religious people, the principle of common good is also very helpful. What is the idea behind the common good? It is holistic and inclusive. It benefits all humankind, including future generations, but also the whole person. So this holistic understanding, the common good is not also about adequate economic well-being, material things, but also health, access to education and information, the ability to express one's thoughts, religious beliefs, and ideals. And if we go to other debates, maybe in the economic world, we have this huge debate on the global commons as a kind of goods, which contrary to the private commons, we also talk about we talk about the social dilemma situations. And this dilemma arises from two incompatible propositions. First, the self-seeking actors behave uncooperatively. Also, efforts to serve the common good would actually be in their interest. But they fear that free riders might exploit this willingness to cooperate. That's the first thing. That's the reason why they are more reactive and not active in this. They fear the free riders' problem. And I think a culture of encounter with the common good in mind could help to overcome this fear of free riding. And that could be the link between the personal conversion, willingness to courage to do the first, to take the first step, to encounter the person in a comprehensive way. And this encounter is more than the cooperation for the sake of mutual benefit, which is at focus in this economical, but even in the political area. And that can help these two encounter to engage, to encourage people not to fear this free rider mentality and behavior. And that could help to motivate people to be change agents as a role model for the culture of encounter. And that's my final remark. We are looking for people, for actors, collective actors, corporations or politicians who are not affected by the fear of free riders and who have the courage and the confidence to bring forward fair agreements and structural reforms through overcoming their fear of getting beaten by free riders. And if a critical mass of such individuals, above all decision makers in business and politics, engage in such a process, they can become ambassadors for a culture of encounter and be the change agents for the reforms we need for tackling our today's challenges.
Thank you, Johannes. I think all three of you have really touched on, in different ways, a central challenge at the heart of Archbishop Gallagher's address, and indeed at the heart of the whole concept of the culture of encounter, which is, you know, how do we take something which has roots in theological reflection, in the gospel, in the Christian message, where we have in the Christian tradition the idea of God encountering humanity in a person. How do you take that and make it relevant in the broader public sphere, not to mention at the global level and the level of global governance? You've discussed, you know, Johannes most recently in your essay, in your remarks, the common good is a kind of bridge concept which might allow us to move from the personal and theological to the political and the global. Marcel, you had some interesting insights about the idea of love, moving from that to human dignity, which can be, in a sense, institutionalized as it has been in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, to justice and questions of institutions and structures. And Catherine, you make the point that to just focus on institutions and structures and processes misses out on a lot of the global challenges we face: economic, social, gender. You mentioned education as well in your essay, that is something that is left out. So maybe we could do another round of reflections, responding to what you've heard and really zeroing in on, you know, how we build that bridge, and really connect the culture of encounter with the idea of the global agenda in productive ways. So Catherine, let me go back to you first for your thoughts.
Well, one thing, again, rereading this speech, but also these reflections, is this sense that the culture of encounter is broken, that we've moved away from mechanisms that might have allowed it in the past. And this is due to a number of factors, including the polarization among nations, but also within nations, and the difficulties of dialogue. So I think that in a sense is the problem that he and we are wrestling with, of how do we do that. Now, I think that Archbishop Gallagher is focusing to a large extent on the sort of nation state structure, because that is, of course, where diplomacy comes out. And I think Johannes's focus on the challenges of the common good and free riders, but also inequities, and both the realities and perceptions of inequities, and how do you see each individual and each nation, in a sense, as having equal dignity and equal status, and how do you deal with the fears that block people's understanding of the common good, and the directions that we can take. So I think that those are important. And I think another sort of line of thought in this culture of encounter would be to look at some of the Truth and Reconciliation Commissions. I looked, and people are counting 54 different national or broader efforts, or even subnational efforts, to clarify the narratives and to look at the truth claims, which again, I think in this focus on peacemaking is such a critical element of trying to be able to humanize, as Marcel is saying, and by humanizing, and reframing the narratives, whether it is the common good or whether it is the bitterness of the past, that in a sense comes back to this notion of what a positive encounter might be as we look forward.
Thank you. Marcel, what are your further thoughts on this?
Thank you very much, Catherine and Johannes. Mine, first of all, to echo some of the points that I saw in reading your papers, I was struck by the link that Catherine makes of the global agendas that are exemplified or illustrated by the Sustainable Development Goals and the link you make with the Catholic social teaching. So even though these sustainable goals may be secular, but they find their also expressions in the Catholic social teaching. And so if you are even on the five P's that you mentioned, so the peace, planet, prosperity, people, partnership, if you are to look at this and couple them with the whole idea of solidarity, human dignity, subsidiarity, or you go to the preferential option for the poor, or care for the environment, you begin to see the link between the Catholic social teaching and these global agenda issues. So I thought, even though someone may not be necessarily a Catholic, they find it, or a Christian, they find their expression in what you are talking about. So that's the first. Then also the second point, reading your paper, see the culture of encounter that requires an attitude of openness. That's the second point. One other point you mentioned. And openness here, I speak as a theologian. One major theologian here is a Canadian Jesuit theologian, Bernard Lonergan. He says, when one is open, then you are able to overcome your own prejudices and biases. And he defines a bias as a distortion to intellectual development. What happens when people disencounter one another, they have blocked one another. So they are biases against one group over the other. And so when you speak of encounter as going beyond a gesture of friendship, but really being open to the other as the other, I find that expression of Bernard Lonergan well expressed. So that's another expression I find. Then again, in an appreciative way, reading Johannes, I think it's beautiful to see how you bring the idea of the common good from a Christian perspective to a global agenda. The common good advocates for adequate economic well-being, health, access to education, information, ability to express one's thoughts. Again, actually, this will join Catherine's points of view from a global perspective. So I see this complementarity. My challenge in a fragmented world today, and I see this in Africa, where I am based, challenges of where people don't want to accept the results of an election. We have seen this in many parts of Africa, challenges of several coup d'etats. So how do you put up structures that foster this common good? And if our sister here, Evelyn, was around, who advocates for a spirituality of encounter, my question was going to be, what concrete steps do you do to have a spirituality of encounter? In a nutshell, I am appreciating the two major points that I find from Catherine's point article, then also the idea of the common good that goes beyond the Catholic perspective, but also how do you put this into practice? That's what I would say for now.
Thank you. Over to you, Johannes.
Yeah, I think maybe I think we have two common lines I see. The first is that we see the multi-crisis situation, the multiple structural injustices, and the exclusion of more and more people, the poorest and most vulnerable, it's fostering a process of disencounter at the moment. That's the thing. And the first need is to be aware of that and to stop and to reverse this process of disencounter by building trust, by building reliable and trusting relationships. That's the first thing I see in all of the three essays. How can we do that? And I see we have several angles, perspectives. We have in the secular political world the SDGs. We have in the social Catholic social teaching our principles and our languages. And I think the main challenge is, and that's what a real encounter needs, is a kind of translating these diverse perspectives on the same aims, ways of overcoming this encounter. And that's why I think that this process of translation, a religious language into a language which is understandable for others and vice versa, is a very important thing. We have to bridge these different phrases, expressions, thoughts of ideas, and to bring them in a process of coming together. And that's what I tried to do with the concept of the global commons. And that's what I see in Catherine's way of bringing the SDGs together with the ideas of Archbishop Gallagher. And that's what I see in Marcel's idea of bringing the categories of love together with the dignity of all person. And I think we have to be aware that the one thing is to bring these ideas into practice, into political practice, into political action. And the second is that we have to be aware that we need to translate these several initiatives, languages, to a common effort. And that's what I tried to bring in, at least a bit, the concept of social capital or social potential at the moment, at the beginning, the ability of societies to build reliable and trusting relationships. And in a more complex, polarized societies within nation states, but also within the global society, we have to overcome these speechlessness in splitting in different language spheres, and not only in the language in a narrow sense, but also in different communities, different systems of values, value principles, and so on.
Thanks, Johannes. You've all raised in different ways a key issue we've been grappling with throughout this project and will continue to grapple with. And maybe this can be our last topic here as we go around one more time. This is the issue you called a translation of the relationship between religious experience, religious discourse, and the wider secular world. And clearly, we all agree, building on your thoughts there, Johannes, that some translation is necessary if one is to build coalitions, if one is to work together across divides and instantiate a culture of encounter that's more than just interpersonal and interreligious. There has to be some bridge to the secular world. We need concepts like the common good, justice, dignity, mutual recognition, and respect. I mean, these are incredibly valuable concepts that do speak to a wider range of human experience beyond the religious. On the other hand, is there a danger of losing what's distinctive here? Other terms, and Gallagher tries to bridge these two worlds, right? He talks about justice and charity. Charity, another way that can be translated is love. Love, mercy, forgiveness. These are parts of universal human experience, so there's a secular component, but they're not really part of secular political discourse. to make them more central to the global conversation? Don't we need to empower religious voices to also speak out of their traditions, even in theological terms, and participate in the global conversation that way? And I know, Catherine, you've thought a lot about this. So let me go back to you for your thoughts on this question.
Yes, this question of translation or interpretation of speaking across different worldviews is a profoundly challenging one. And I think it goes alongside something that is linked to this discussion about the common good, that in interreligious dialogue, and I think this is a point that Alberto Maloney makes, and when he talks about constantly repeating the first mile of agreeing on certain basic principles and on our interconnectedness and on the humanity, the importance of humanity, without being willing to go to the second and the third mile, which is where there are real differences. And I think that is a challenge of how do you take people who are whose language and whose approach can be so very, very different, of course, to recognize and to put aside their fears that prevent them from seeing this real common interest and the need for the common good, but also to be willing to address the many complexities and the many differences of view, and working with the differences to see if there is a possibility for better solutions or for finding ways to live with difference. So I think that that is the challenge. And I've worked, as you know, very much in this secular world and trying to bring the religious dimension into it, which is, in my experience, surprisingly difficult. I mean, I would argue, for example, that one of the most powerful messages coming from the common religious experience is the concern for the vulnerable and is the preferential option for the poor, translating that into in the immediate world at the United Nations General Assembly this week. How far will there truly be a focus by the nation states who are those who are gathered on dealing with the humanitarian crises, whether they are refugees, forced migration, the food crisis, the countless other crises that face the world. And the problem, it does come back to one of the central messages in Archbishop Gallagher's speech, but also I think in many of my own frustrations, is how do you take these words that people speak and the noble thoughts and even the noble intentions, and I would say force them into thinking more concretely about what that means in action, and how do you translate this common human urge, which I think goes to the earliest years of babies, for fairness, for some kind of balance, for a reckoning with the powerful and the unfairness in the world, and translate that into something that at least comes closer to the ideals that we all put forth.
Thank you. Marcel, what are your thoughts?
Thank you once again. Being some concluding remarks, I think what this culture of encounter, drawing from Archbishop Gallagher or even Arturo Sosa, the Superior General of the Church of Jesus, or our own encounters when we're in Rome, and even this particular one, I think there is an idea that we are really into something of a pilgrim of hope. How could I say that? Despite the divisions we see around us, there are people who wants to show that we can still give a message that that humanity can offer better. So that's what I have seen with this whole project. pilgrims of hope. I saw this with the different people from religious backgrounds that we had in Rome, or the different presentations that have been made. So if I were to put it in one expression, pilgrims of hope, that's what I have seen with this whole project. That can be fleshed out. They say we met the people who came from India, we came Muslims, several Muslims. You remember the leader who was not able to speak, I think wasn't speaking English, but his message was profound. I see that really agents or pilgrims of hope. That's one. So something to continue. Secondly, I think what this tells me, given what listening to Catherine, to Johannes, I see, and we are coming from different backgrounds, but all this summarized, at least from a theological perspective, I see that this project has brought theology to the public square. At least from my, so what contribution does theology bring at the service of society? And that's what I see. Catherine may not be a theologian, but I see something really coming out. How does a discourse on God speak to human heart across all religions? So that I have seen. Tom, you have helped us to reimagine how theology can be useful to society. So the invitation of Gallagher, or the Superior General of the Society of Jesus, and others, I think, have brought that to the fore. And lastly, I think what we have been involved in is actually another way of putting the synod on synodality into practice. The ongoing synod on synodality into practice from this one angle of encounter. So we have allowed people to speak out. We have allowed the measures of inclusion, ecumenism, interreligious dialogue. So this has been actually a concrete synod, if I would say. So three points: pilgrims of hope, theology in public square and its contribution, and think that has become very clear. And then we have become really synod fathers and mothers.
Thank you, Marcel, for your reflections, not just on our conversation, but on the project as a whole. And thanks to all of you. Johannes, let's have some final thoughts from you as well.
Yeah, thank you. Marcel, I like these three points very much. And following this last round and the introducing question by Tom, the distinction of Michael Walter came up to my mind between the thick and thin concepts, ethical concepts. Maybe that could be helpful to think in this way. On the one side, we need to have these thick ethical concepts influenced, inspired by theological aspects, as Marcel said, pilgrims of hope. And on the other side, we also need a kind of thin concept, which is really bridgeable to other concepts who are non-believers or others. And if we think in these two perspectives of thick and thin in a globalized world, and not as an either or, but in a way as well as, we need both perspectives, this thick and thin, and maybe that could be a way of bringing these two things. Tom, you mentioned the advantages and the problems of bridging these religious ideas into the secular world. Maybe that could be a kind of dialectic between thick and thin, and we need as a kind of enriching a process for those who are religious people. But I think this aspect of pilgrims of hope could also be understandable by non-believers in this, because hope is a category which could be a link to this same concept of ethical thinking of our today's challenges. Maybe that and that also counts for the other things, theology in public sphere, and also the synodality could be phrased in the dialectic of thin and thick ethical concepts. And maybe we should think about if this could be helpful for our today's challenges.
Thank you, Johannes, and thank you, all of you. I think we've made some real progress in focusing in on some of the challenges that lie ahead as well. And the category of hope that you mentioned, Marcel, that you echo, Johannes, I think is a critical one. Obviously, one that resonates across religious traditions, but is an easier translation, I think, to a wider secular audience than some of the other theological concepts that we've been wrestling with. So thanks so much for the conversation, and look forward to next steps together.